All right, let's get right into it. You know, at the very heart of economics, there's this one simple universal challenge. We can't have everything we want. There are always limits. But what actually defines those limits? And maybe more importantly, how do we push past them? I mean, you feel this every single day, right? You only have so many hours. You can either cram for that big test or you can go hang out with your friends, but you probably can't do both perfectly. That feeling, that tension of having to make a choice, that's basically economics in a nutshell. And it turns out, entire countries face the exact same problem, just on a much, much bigger scale. So to help visualize this, economists use this really neat tool called the Production Possibility Curve, or PPC. Now, don't let the technical name throw you. Just think of it as a boundary of what's possible. Everything inside that line, you can do. Everything outside of it, nope, not possible. At least, not right now. To make this super simple, let's imagine a guy named Danny, stranded on an island.
Okay, so Danny has a certain amount of time and energy, right? If he goes all in on fishing, he can catch 20 fish a day. If he totally switches gears and only gathers coconuts, he can get 50. Now, he can also get some mix of the two, but what he can't do is get 20 fish and 50 coconuts. That's just, it's outside his boundary. That line represents his own personal economic limit.
So that brings up a really good question. What actually creates this boundary in the first place? I mean, for Donnie, it's pretty clear. It's his time, his skill, his energy. But for a whole economy, what are those fundamental ingredients that set the absolute limit on what a country can produce?
Well, they have a name, of course. Economists call them the factors of production. And these are the absolute bedrock of any economy, whether we're talking about Danny's little island or a global superpower.
And there are three main ones you gotta know. First up, you've got labor. This is the human element, right? The workers, the engineers, the teachers. Sometimes you'll hear it called human capital. Second is capital. Now, hold on. This doesn't mean money. In economics, capital means the tools, the machines, the factories, all the stuff you use to make other stuff. And finally, you have land. And this is basically shorthand for all natural resources. We're talking everything from the soil and trees to oil in the ground.
Yeah, this analogy is perfect. Think about baking a loaf of bread. You need the baker, that's your labor. You need the oven, that's your capital. And you need the flour, which comes from wheat grown in the ground, that's your land. Pretty much every single thing you can think of is made from some combination of these three ingredients.
So this brings us right back to our big problem. Danny wants more fish and more coconuts. Countries want more goods and services. If everything you can produce is limited by these ingredients, well, how do you get more? How do you actually grow?
And this is where things get really interesting. Because that boundary we talked about, it's not set in stone. You can actually move it. Pushing that line outward is exactly what we call economic growth. And it turns out there are two main ways to pull it off.
Okay, so path one is pretty straightforward. You just get more ingredients, more workers, more machines, more resources. Path two is a little different. It's about improving the recipe. It's about using technology and smarter ideas to get more output from the same amount of ingredients. Now, that second path is a huge deal, but to really get the basic principle down, we're gonna focus on path number one today.
So we're zeroing in on that first idea, simply increasing the quantity of your factors of production. This could mean building new factories, that's more capital, or it could mean discovering a new oil field, that's more land. But to keep things really simple, let's head back to Danny's island and see how this works with labor.
Let's say Danny decides he wants to increase one of his inputs, his own labor. So he decides, you know what? I'm going to start working 12 hours a day instead of 10. He is literally putting more of a factor of production into his own little personal economy.
And boom, look at the result. With just those two extra hours of work, his entire world of possibilities expands. He can now get a maximum of 24 fish instead of 20. Or a maximum of 60 coconuts instead of 50. His whole economic boundary, that line we drew, it has literally shifted outward.
And that's the key takeaway here. By simply increasing the quantity of just one input, in this case his labor, Danchi achieved real measurable economic growth. The world of what's possible for him is now bigger. The same thing would have happened if he built a second fishing net, right? That's just more capital.
Okay, so this isn't just some abstract theory about a guy on an island. This exact principle is a fundamental part of economic strategy for entire nations. Let's take a look at how this plays out in the real world.
I mean, just look at how different countries have tackled this.
To fuel its incredible post-war recovery, Germany invited millions of so-called guest workers from Turkey. The United States has famously used immigration, with things like the Green Card Lottery, to bring in new people and new skills. The history of Israel shows this really clear connection between big waves of immigration and major periods of economic expansion. And even when Denmark accepted refugees, one of the economic effects was an increase in its potential labor pool.
See? The logic is exactly the same as Donnie's, just on a massive national scale. These countries all understood that to grow, you need more of the key ingredients. In these examples, the ingredient was labor. But the logic holds true if a country builds more roads and ports, that's more capital, or discovers massive shale gas reserves, that's more land. It's all about pushing that national production possibility curve outward.
Which, it leaves us with one final, pretty important thought to chew on. We've spent all this time seeing how adding resources, more labor, more capital, fuels growth and pushes that boundary out. So what happens when it goes in reverse? What happens to an economy when its population starts to shrink, or its resources run out, or its factories are destroyed? It's definitely something to think about.